It's been 10 years since the tragic death of one of Australia's greatest motorsport legends, Peter Brock. All these years later, there are still questions about the off-track drama surrounding the man they nicknamed Peter Perfect, but who, in reality, was just another flawed human being like the rest of us. Today, we'll be given a unique insight into the man behind the legend from two voices that have rarely been heard. Joining ITA for this television exclusive is the woman he planned to marry, Julie Bamford, and Peter Brock's younger brother, Lewis.
For 10 years.
Yeah.
What do you remember of that day, Julie?
Almost too much, in a way, now. As time's gone on, it's becoming more clear. I've got more clarity about it. At the beginning, it was much more of a blur, but the main memory is disbelief.
When you went to see the body to identify Peter...
Yeah.
You conducted a personal marriage ceremony.
I did. I felt compelled, and I think it was because it was a plan that we had for 2 months ahead of getting married. And I just looked and automatically went into it. And I didn't even think about it. I didn't even think about it after it. It was just like something that felt natural to do. And I was told later on that it was long-term longing and completion of our plans.
You're not often called his fiancée, are you?
No.
No. So people didn't realise that you were his fiancée? Mm,
I was. And the thing was, I guess, that it hadn't been put out there only to family and friends. But we hadn't announced it to the world, so to speak. It was quite private, really.
And he'd asked you to marry him when you were in Paris.
Underneath
the Eiffel Tower.
Underneath the Eiffel. Yeah, there's a photo of us.
And you're wearing the engagement ring?
Here, yeah. I took it off this hand because I wore it for a couple of years then. I just thought, I've got to try to disconnect a bit. Try.
So is that one underneath?
This one here. It's a beautiful spiral.
Diamond.
Which was quite symbolic at the time.
So as his fiancée, how do you feel when people call you his mistress?
Terrible. Not right, because it was a lot more than that. A lot of people didn't even realise that we'd known each other for 20 years, which was a long time. It was a long time. I got to know each other really well on a lot of levels. It was a natural progression. I actually didn't think he would ask me to marry him, but he actually went to Lewis and had a chat to Lewis about it.
Well, he never married Bev, did he?
Well, no, he didn't. He didn't. My mum asked him why he didn't when he went to see her, and he gave his reason, and then she understood more.
What was the reason?
I think the reason was that he hadn't felt like he wanted to, whether it's he didn't need to or he just never felt compelled to go to that length. Most people think that they did get married, and most people say, oh, his first wife that he was married to, and...
Bev changed her name to Brock, and that's why people think that
she was
his wife.
And that's a natural assumption.
Mm. Now, Lewis, you think of Julie as your sister-in-law.
Yes, I do.
And did Peter share his feelings for Julie with you?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, he did. I was quite surprised, because after Peter left Bev, I didn't realise that he had that relationship with Julie. Until, in fact, he was mooning around for a while, and I'm thinking, does he have someone he wants to meet? Should I introduce him to my friends? Or, but he just came out and said, "No, look, I'm very happy. I love Julie dearly, and you know, she's the one for me for the rest of my life." That's what he wanted.
So, if he hadn't been killed, you would have married him 2 months later after that date.
Well, that's right.
You had a very long relationship with Peter. You were best friends with Bev.
Yeah.
You were married?
I was.
You were all friends?
Yeah, but it was more myself with Peter and Bev than my ex-husband.
So people must say, how do you justify having a relationship like that?
Well, I don't. I can't justify it. It went against all of my beliefs and values. I never thought that I'd be in that position. I wasn't looking for that. But it was just something that came along, and I had an instant rapport for a long time. We both did, but didn't really acknowledge it but quite some years later.
So how did it begin?
It was difficult, our relationship, as in the way...
I mean, well, you had a relationship because you're all friends together, but somewhere along the way, the relationship changed.
Right. Well, the interesting thing was that the first thing that Bev had said to me was that Peter wanted to meet me. And I'm thinking, well, that's really interesting. OK. So I met him at their house and I just thought, oh, yeah. So this is Peter Brock, and I didn't like motor racing a bit, to be honest. I just thought it was a bit silly.
A bit silly?
A bit silly. I didn't understand it, except over the years there was always Peter Brock in the background on the, you know, Bathurst, and I used to watch with not that much feeling, except what's this about?
So when did you realise that that he was in love with you and you were in love with him?
Probably 5 years down the track, I was starting to think, well, this is... there's something going on here. There's something up. But, of course, as society says, you're married, you don't go there. So I felt very conflicted in what I was thinking and feeling. And on speaking to Peter later on, it was the same. It was the same scenario for both of us. Bev said, well, look, you guys are interested in art because we're both artistic. He's an amazing artist. How about going up to Bendigo to a friend's place who's painting the Archibald Prize, why don't you go together? And I thought, well, this is interesting, this is really weird. I thought, yeah, well, it's great, great opportunity. And it was probably from that day that we both thought, there's something really strong here.
Well, in this recent Woman's Day article, Lewis, you actually say that Bev encouraged the relationship.
Peter left Bev and lived on his own for a couple of months. That's when I said he was mooning around, what is he doing, coming to my place and speaking to Bonnie and I. Then when he declared his love for Julie to me, and I had no idea prior to that, well, it was on July 4th, I think, that they got together. Mm-hmm. And after that, they visited together and then they had the conversations about...
So where are we now, about 2005 or 4?
Yes, yeah,
or
we something are. Like that.
2005, Julie.
Yeah. Okay, well, we had Bev on Studio 10.
Sure.
And she spoke to us and she said that she didn't see Peter's philanderings as a way of cheating on her. So let's have a listen to what she said. Have a look at this.
Okay. Well, how did you cope and how did you feel when you found out that Peter was cheating on you?
Look, I come from a totally different perspective to what is portrayed out there, because I don't see it like that. 95% of our 28 years was absolutely stunning. We had a loving, caring, fantastic team. Partnership, great.
I don't know. A lot of the times before 2005, before we started to live together, we had a lot of opportunity with, you know, Bev basically saying, well, let's go out, it's your birthday, three of us are going out.
He did have a reputation as a womaniser. Do you think that perhaps by encouraging your relationship, she was able to keep tabs on him and she was sort of in control? Because you at some point said to her... Yeah. I would never take him away from
right.
you. And you told her.
Yeah.
And she told you that you couldn't because he needed her.
That's right. That's exactly what she did say. So in my mind it was like, okay, you can see this person. It was like a bit of an understanding, which I sort of didn't get in a way, but I didn't really think about it till Peter and I started to live together, and I thought I'd been part of a plan, not by Peter, but by Bev.
It's hard to understand her plan.
Okay.
I mean, there was a suggestion that she encouraged you one day to lie on the bed with her and Peter. Can you remember that time?
I do. I do remember that.
I thought that very unusual.
Well, I just went and laid down next to her and she said, go and lay next to Peter, he's nicer to lay next to. And so I just automatically did. But I felt kind of quite relaxed because the intent was that we were just going to do this meditation because three of us were quite spiritual.
Is that all that happened?
That's all that happened. That's all that happened. Absolutely.
So did she encourage you to have a sexual relationship as well?
Well, she didn't say that, no. There was no mention of that. There was a relationship between us as friends and families, and our kids knew their kids and all of that. But a lot of the time it was basically Peter, Bev and I. We all had the same interests. It was about bettering yourselves, making a difference on the planet. So there was a like scenario going on there about how we wanted life to be. But, you know, I actually, at the end when Peter left, Bev, I did say to her, look, I never for one moment thought that it would come to this. I never for one moment thought this would happen. And I actually said, but Bev, you need to take some responsibility in this.
Why? Because she encouraged you?
Well, yeah. And it was sort of made easier. I don't know whether she was testing our friendship or not or what, but it felt that it went, for me, beyond that. I never thought I'd end up in another relationship outside of my marriage. It certainly taught me not to make judgment about anybody.
Did you like Bev?
I really have a lot of respect for Bev. I think that's probably the best way. I don't think we were ever really good friends, but I certainly respected her. She took care of both of my parents as they grew older and eventually passed away. Bonnie's father, the same thing.
That's your wife, Bonnie?
Bonnie, my wife, yeah. And that's more what my relationship is. We've never really had a social relationship.
She didn't come between you you and Peter at all? There's the brothers.
I didn't feel very welcome to come and visit a lot at their house. I have to say that.
You weren't asked to meditate on the bed, in other words?
Never. No, no. And the interesting thing was that I was quite into that myself. Yeah. I kind of thought that might happen with Peter and Bev because I was of a like mind, but it didn't.
It must be really difficult, though, to be in love with someone who has had a very long-term relationship with a woman who calls herself his wife, even though she isn't.
Mm.
She's encouraged you with your relationship. I think she's encouraged you to have a sexual relationship. I mean, that must be implied, I would have thought. You're all grown-up people and you did move in with Peter.
Yep.
I just wondered, do you reflect on it sometimes? Do you think it was all worthwhile?
Absolutely.
But what did you give?
The same interest.
What did you give him that Bev couldn't or didn't? Because that's what I'm just puzzling about here.
So I just said to him, "Why did you pick me to be with?" And he said, "Well, I've thought the same thing. Why did you pick me?" And we both just had a really good laugh. I don't know. We got to know each other over 20 years before we lived together.
And Ida's exclusive interview with Julie Bamford and Lewis Brock will continue right after this short break.